members.
Okay. The next item on the order paper is a motion on sporting events and activity-based tourism. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the marshal list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I'll ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly welcomes the success that the Executive has had in attracting major sporting events in recent years and attracting visitors engaged in sports tourism. Notes the high value economic benefits that can arise from events-based and activity-based sports tourism, and calls on the Minister for the Economy, through his department, agencies and the new tourism strategy, to promote and encourage growth in this sector.
Thank you, and I call Mr Gordon Lyons to move the motion. Sorry, change of order. I call Mr Gordon Dunn to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. It is confusing. Too many Gordons. I very much welcome the opportunity to propose this motion today. Event tourism is something that has been a very real success story for us here in Northern Ireland, with a whole host of high-profile, prestigious sporting events being successfully held over recent years. The opportunities to bring events and people to our shores has increased dramatically with the normalisation of life here in Northern Ireland, and I believe the Executive must be commended for helping to bring about the success stories we have had of sporting events here in recent years. We all recognise the very real opportunities that now exist through our long tradition in sport and culture, which must be exploited and developed to ensure we reach our full potential to bring tourists to Northern Ireland. Sporting events and activity-based tourism can bring significant economic benefits to our country and our economy. They can help to transform communities, regenerate areas, deliver much-needed employment and inspire future generations. Although we have had considerable success in this sector over recent years, we must never be complacent and must continue to strive for more events, bigger audiences and ultimately more investment within our economy. To continue to attract top-level events to our shores, we need to ensure the conditions are right and that they are in place. One of the key ingredients is getting the right infrastructure in place. We need to continue to invest in a roads network, air links, ports, accommodation and telecommunications. Event tourism needs more affordable accommodation in close proximity to planned events. We currently have 13,560 beds available through the various accommodation sectors, with 7,860 of these within our hotels. It is most encouraging and very positive that there are 9 new hotels and 2 large extensions planned within the Belfast area, which will create an additional 1,500 beds. Within the North Down area, in my own constituency, a new 85-bedroom Premier Inn is planned for Bangor. This will be ideal for visitors, and particularly for those competitors using the Aurora Aquatic Centre. Indeed, this is still in the planning stage, and I would urge the planning service through the Council to make this a priority. Some of the very successful high-profile events which have been held over recent years include the Irish Open Golf Tournaments, the World Police and Fire Games, the Giro d'Italia, the Circuit of Ireland Rally, the North West 200 and the Grand Fonda, to name but a few.
Would the member give way?
Yes, I will do.
Would the member agree with me with the Giro d'Italia coming here in 2014? Not only did it bring tourists, but has encouraged families and communities to get involved in cycling, which also brings great health benefits as well.
Yes, I would agree with certainly with my colleague, who is a good ambassador for cycling, as I'm sure you all know and see him around, cycling around, particularly within his own constituency in East Belfast. The positive PR gained from these types of events for Northern Ireland PLC cannot be underestimated. The television coverage and the live streaming beamed across the world from these events showcasing some of our spectacular scenery is very valuable and can act as a real magnet for tourism for the years to come. All of these events attract competitors from right across the world, bringing them, their families and their teams to our country, often for the first time. These visitors often go away with very fond memories of not only having competed in a fantastic event with top-class facilities and a magnetic atmosphere, but also they are also often touched by the warmth and enthusiasm of our local people. They go home with very fond memories and an experience which they can share around the world. The ongoing success of our national football team is also a real success story. The fantastic performance of Northern Ireland in the European Championships when they made their way through to the last 16 really helped to put this country on the world map. The impact of the team and the fans was incredible, and the many people across the world now know where Northern Ireland is for the right reasons and that it is capable of doing something positive that we can now build upon. The team's success can have a ripple effect right across our community for years to come in inspiring young people and increasing participation in sport, whilst also attracting tourists to visit here and helping to build on our reputation. Golf tourism is another growth sector, and I welcome tourism's NI strategic review within this sector, which aims to grow the value of golf tourism from $33 million to $50 million by 2020. We are the home of champions, and I know many golf clubs have taken this initiative to build upon the success of our homegrown golfing superstars. I know the Hollywood Golf Club within my own constituency is an example of this, and they have enjoyed great interest from tourists from around the world, many from the United States, all eager to see and play on the course where our own Rory McIlroy learnt his skills. I have no doubt the investment in the future Irish Opens and the Open coming in 2019 will only help to further grow this sector. Motorsport is another area where we have a proud and proven track record of not only hosting top events, but also of producing top talent capable of taking on the world, from Paddy Hopkirk right up to Chris Meek in the present day. Rally Ireland had the honour of being a round of the World Rally Championship in 2007 and 2009, attracting huge interest in this country. I believe we have real opportunities to build upon the success of events like the Circuit of Ireland Rally in recent years through the European Rally Championship and once again hosting the Premier World Rally Champion in the future. Events like the Northwest 200 and the Ulster Grand Prix also build on our proud tradition of road racing and attract thousands of spectators and competitors every year, both of these events bring a great boost to our local area and to our economy. I am aware of the exciting plans for a new hotel and visitor centre close to the Northwest track, and that is something which I welcome and I feel can only but benefit our local economy. There is also potential to develop our local racetracks like Bishop's Court and Kirkeston in order to once again attract top-level championships like the British Superbikes and the British Touring Car Championship. Mr. Speaker, there is no doubt that we have enjoyed considerable success in recent years in hosting major sporting events and attracting visitors through sports tourism. However, I firmly believe we have even greater potential in this sector and must continue to invest strategically to attract greater events that will help to build and develop our country. I would call on the Minister to recognise this and ensure that the new tourism strategy continues to promote and encourage growth in this sector. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Members, as question time begins at 2 o'clock, I suggest that the House takes its ease until then. The debate will continue after question time, when the next member to speak will be Mr. Justin McNulty to move the amendment.
We will now return to the debate on sporting events and activity-based tourism. Éireann Sir Justin McNulty on Lasso Abogo. I call Justin McNulty to move the amendment, and the member will have 10 minutes.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Principal Deputy Speaker, this morning the Speaker very helpfully guided the House with regards to oral answers by our questions by ministers, oral statements by ministers in the House. Having had the opportunity to peruse standing orders, it would be helpful, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, if the Speaker, as well as giving, making requests to ministers, would also point out the veracity of standing orders, which does say that in the circumstances of where a minister is free to attend the House, we're not on holiday or closed down, it's a standing day of the Assembly, that there should be no reason for a minister not to come and make an oral statement to the House. And I do refer to an impending statement by the Minister of Infrastructure tomorrow, which will be given in writing rather than orally to the House.
I thank the member for his point of order, and I will certainly refer the matter to the Speaker. Éireamh Saoire, Justin McNulty. I call Justin McNulty.
Madam Deputy Speaker, I welcome this opportunity to take part in this debate today, and I rise to propose the amendment in my name and that of my party colleagues. I urge all in the House to support the amendment, which reflects the needs of sporting and tourism sectors and matches our ambitions in this region. We must recognise the achievement of our tourist agencies and sporting organisations in helping to attract major sporting events. Our successes in promoting tourist events is in part in thanks due to the Executive, but also due to the sheer determination of our tourism agencies and sporting organisations. And for that, we must be grateful. Can I thank the proposers of this motion for bringing forward this debate and giving us an opportunity to talk about our great sporting record? As has already been mentioned, over recent years we have hosted prestigious events such as the Irish Open in 2012 and 2015, and we'll do so again next year. We will also host the Open Championship in 2019. And of course, there is the bid to host the 2023 Rugby World Cup. This is an exhilarating possibility and opportunity. The thought of having the All Blacks based in Armagh City is a mouth-watering prospect, and I'm invigorated by the lasting positive impact that could have for our young people. For all of Ireland, hosting the Rugby World Cup can leave a legacy we can all be proud of. We have hosted the World Police and Fire Games and the Giro d'Italia. That's not to mention the regional events, which are homegrown and unique. And whilst we don't hear about all of those events, they range from international fishing competitions on the River Bann or in Lough Neagh, the Northern Ireland Game and Country Fair, or County Fair at Scarva, the ploughing at Mullaghhead, the Crooked Lake Triathlon, UK Indoor Bowling Championships, the points-to-points, the point-to-points in places like Farmaclaffley, or entirely unique to Armagh, are the Road Bowls, or Bullets, King of the Road, and All-Ireland Championships, which are held in Tassa annually. Madam Deputy Speaker, in working to attract large-scale sporting events, we must look to the work already happening across the region in our local sporting organisations. It would be remiss of me not to mention the contribution of the GEA. In Armagh City alone, the athletic grounds attracts over 175 visitors a year. Across County Armagh, over 300,000 visitors attend games, 300,000 people attend games throughout the year, and yet this goes unrecognised across government. I must praise the Armagh County Board in the work they did to deliver a modern, fan-friendly stadium. And of course, this is not to mention the other clubs and counties across Ulster. Only yesterday I was in Park Essler in Uri for a game where Kilcoo hosted Mahari in the Senior Ulster Club Championship with upwards of 10,000 people, paying for the privilege of watching amateur players in the comfort of a modern stand. Whilst all of these sporting occasions are a fantastic asset for our tourism offering, to date, the approach adopted in attracting global events has been too piecemeal. We have sought to attract one event at a time without any strategic vision or direction. This is why Northern Ireland urgently needs a tourism strategy. Central and local government must work together with sporting bodies and organisations on those events, both large-scale and small. Madam Deputy Speaker, if we are to look at growing this market, we must be bold and ambitious, both in planning but also in our support for such projects by way of marketing, promotion and capital requirements. This region must host teams and games, but we need to develop our infrastructure, our sporting, hospitality and transport infrastructure. If we are to host the Rugby World Cup in 2023, we need an early enterprise between Dublin and Belfast. We must encourage new and exciting partnerships where government and numerous sporting bodies can come together and develop facilities for training and hosting teams. The legacy these games can leave for our people can be one of sportsmanship, social inclusion, a fitter and healthier population, and one that recognises that sport unites us, that sport brings out the best in us. All of these can be achieved with an ambitious and accurate strategy, one which both the executive and the tourism sector support. It is disappointing, Madam Deputy Speaker, that the only notable development we have had in recent times in regards to inward tourism is in fact the loss of the United Airlines New York route between Belfast and New York City. Maximising sports and event tourism relies on convenience and ease of travel for fans. Global events like the Open Championship can only have the transformative effect on local economies if they're accessible in as few movements as possible for international travellers. The loss of the United route is therefore extremely worrying, meaning that the lucrative US fan market is less likely to make the journey if they have to travel through London or Dublin. It also underscores the critical need to improve the transport infrastructure throughout this island, as Dublin becomes the primary port for US travellers. We need a reliable early enterprise service to be incorporated as part of any tourism strategy, as a minimum. As well as this, a potential UK exit from the EU poses huge challenges for Northern Ireland, and amongst them is the impact it could have on our tourism industry and wider economy. With the uncertainty that the referendum result has brought, now more than ever, the tourism sector needs the government to create a favourable environment for tourism to expand, to flourish, and to contribute to our local economy. The executive must take the earliest opportunity to promote and enhance the tourism sector, and fundamental to this is the development of a tourism strategy. Key amongst our proposals to protect and promote the tourism sector has been a long-term call for reduction in VAT on tourism and hospitality products, putting the North services on a level playing field with those in the South. Harmonising this rate across this island is a no-brainer. Our debates on this issue have received cross-party support both here and in the House of Commons. It's disappointing that this proposal hasn't yet been adopted. In conclusion, Madam Deputy Speaker, the SELP, for our part, will continue to press for the introduction of a fit-for-purpose tourism strategy which addresses the capital, resource, marketing, skills, training and infrastructure requirements of the sports events and tourism sector. The executive must do more to develop and support our tourism industry as a key economic driver. And to do this, they must prioritise a tourism strategy, the aim of which must be to deliver real and sustainable growth. And that is the aim of our amendment today. Madam Deputy Speaker, this is a debate which we must continue in the months ahead. Attracting sports events is one thing, but leaving a legacy for all our people is another. We can and must do more for the betterment of everyone in this place. We can build an infrastructure to be proud of, a capacity within our sporting sector that means that we are the place to go for major sporting events. I look forward to the day the legendary All Blacks perform a ceremonial haka on the historic Mall in Armagh, when we welcome them to Ireland as their host city in the 2023 Rugby World Cup. Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker.
Éirim Sir Conor Murphy. I call Conor Murphy.
Thank you very much, and I also rise to support the motion. I think it goes without saying, and the experience certainly over the last number of years is that events around sports, great sporting events that have come to this part of the world have certainly raised the profile very substantially and have had enormous benefit in terms of the community. And I know the proposer of the motion has outlined a whole series of the large events, and I was very proud to see the Giro coming through Armagh and down through South Armagh as well. And I think that the sense of a buzz in the community that that event created was one of the most exciting times in the area that I have seen, certainly since my colleague over here and his teammates won the All-Ireland for Armagh in 2002. There was such a buzz around the community relations that event. And of course, we need to see those events happen, and we need to see the infrastructure that goes with them. But I want to focus just on my contribution to this debate on the smaller scale, and some of them have been mentioned. And I make no apologies for the previous speaker mentioned the Crooked Lake Triathlon in Camlach, which happens in our village. Started out as a very small community event, and within 5-6 years was attracting 600 plus competitors from all across Ireland and right across other parts of Europe as well. And that started out just with a local small committee in the community beginning an event, building their own capacity and building their own organisational skills, and creating an event then which became almost international standards. And I think that when we recognise in the headline events and the big focus is on some of the major, the Golf Opens and the Giros and other events, the Rugby World Cup events like that, we should also make sure that there is support in communities for small-scale events, because those are the events that people who have moved away come home for. Those are the events that people time their holidays to come back to Ireland for, to those small events which bring communities together. So as well as ensuring that councils have the necessary resources to support them, I think we should also ensure that there are programmes through perhaps the Department of Communities for capacity building in those communities to ensure that local people get the skills necessary. Because from that small event, we now have a water festival, and we now have the same group of people putting a bid in for the World Ice Swimming Championships to be held in Uri in 2019, which will bring an international event. That all came from a small community project, and it shows you what is possible. I'd also like to, the previous speaker also touched on the GAA, and I've been very fortunate when I've visited other countries to go to their sporting events. I've been to baseball in America, I've been to Balata in the Basque Country where we saw handball getting played. And the GAA is a unique sporting organisation, it is unique to this island, and it has a huge, although it's a global brand now, but it is unique to this island in terms of it's our sport, and it's a sport which is developed here. And I think more should be woven into a tourism strategy in terms of promoting the GAA and that the attraction that it provides. And we can see certainly since it's gone on to Sky Sports how that has become much more of a worldwide attraction. And my colleague here in front of me, who's a keen cyclist, instructed me that it was to mention the RAS as well, which is another unique cycle event to Ireland, and one which hasn't as yet come north of the border. And we'd like to see that come up here as well. So I think there is a lot of work can be done at that local level to ensure that the small events which bind communities together receive the proper support and the proper recognition in a tourism strategy. In relation briefly to the amendment, I mean, I struggle to see merit in it, I have to say. I mean, it appears just in a kind of mean-spirited way to try and dilute any credit from the executive and pass it on to organisations. Of course, the organisations themselves, the sporting organisations and the arm's-length bodies in executive departments do a huge amount of work, but they do so under direction from a minister and under agreed resource from the executive. And I mean, in the previous executive, I know his colleague has now left, was sitting beside the previous speaker. I mean, when a planning decision was taken in relation to Ravenhill Park, it didn't stop the then minister going out and firing a rugby ball about in front of the cameras to claim the credit for that decision. So I don't see the need to dilute any credit from the executive in this regard. And I also, in terms of the urgency of the... I would expect all the things that have been said in the proposer of the amendment to be in that tourism strategy. But I want to see a tourism strategy which is well done and timely, and which listens to the voices in this debate today and incorporates those into the tourism strategy. So I want to see it, rather than an urgent one, I want to see a proper one. I want to see one which gives the level of support which is required, which recognises that events-based tourism is a growing force in terms of tourism and attracting people and the well-being that brings to host communities and the communities generally in terms of health and community cohesion. So if a tourism strategy recognises that, it must be done in a timely fashion, but it must be done properly, not just...
Can the member bring his comments to a close?
Cora Malgan, last one.
Thank you. I call Alan Chambers.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. There is nothing in the DUP motion in front of us today that anyone could not acknowledge. There have been huge successes that have made us all very proud. However, I am disappointed that it makes no reference to the many organisers of major sporting events in Northern Ireland, or indeed those across the entire tourism industry, who do so much to make a visit here an unforgettable experience, especially when events or sports is the magnet. The motion calls on the Minister for the Economy to promote and encourage growth in this sector. Does that mean that the proposers of this motion feel he is not already doing what they request? It will be interesting if the Minister in his contribution today will share with us what he thinks he is not already doing that this motion will fire him up to now deliver. It is also a disappointment to me as a new member to be reminded that such a success as our sporting events and activity-based tourism is not embraced by a specific tourism strategy, despite being talked about throughout the life of the last mandate and has still been talked about today. I have the sense that this type of backslapping motion with a call for the Minister to do what I would expect him to be doing already only serves to feed into the perception held by many members of the public that this House is only a talking shop with no outcomes. That perception can be understood even though we who serve here know that things do actually get done both in this chamber and in committee rooms. At a meeting in October 2014 of the North-South Parliamentary Association, a report was produced on the topics we are discussing today. They talked about events-based and activity tourism. They then referenced a third category called nostalgia-based sports tourism. However, they said that this type of opportunity is not prominent in the Republic of Ireland or Northern Ireland. Why have we not got a museum in Northern Ireland dedicated to the proud sporting achievements over many years of a population of 1.8 million people who box well above their weight on the international stage? Is there a sport organised in this country that has not produced either a world champion, a record breaker, or a medal winner? And that success is also replicated by our Paralympians. I know there is a call for a museum of achievement that would embrace sport, but we have a wealth of material in the sporting world and a story to tell that would fill two sports museums. The challenge will not be what to include, but what to leave out. Look at the success of the Titanic Centre. A sporting museum could replicate that success and appeal to visitors attending major sporting events in the future in our country and provide added value to their experience. Using some of the interactive technology deployed in the Titanic Centre, a sports museum could be made a family-friendly must-visit for our own citizens. Nothing cuts across and makes a mockery of the divides in our society like sport. Let's use it to showcase all our sporting achievements on a cross-community basis. The material is there, the story is there, let's use it. The Ulster Unionist Party will be supporting the SDLP amendment today and calls on the Executive to embrace our idea to promote the establishment of a sporting museum. It makes no sense to continue to miss this opportunity that is sitting on our laps. Let's not dilute the opportunity by concentrating on a museum of achievement that would include sport. That concept would not add value to visitors on either an event or sporting activity break. Mr. McNulty referred to sport providing a legacy. I believe that the pride that we have in the sporting achievements of all our sportsmen across this country in every discipline, a sport museum would be a legacy to those people. So I would call on the Executive to really to embrace this concept and also call on them to urgently stop talking about a tourism strategy, but get one, and you'll have your opportunity to speak, but get a tourism strategy on the books now. Thank you very much, Principal.
Well done.
I call Stephen Farry.
Deputy Speaker, I rise in support of both the motion and the amendment, but before making some very direct points in terms of the motion, could just reflect on some of the things that Alan Chambers has just said in terms of, I think, what's a rather self-congratulatory tone to the motion. I think that's of concern in two respects. I mean, first of all, it always is welcome that we have a debate in the Assembly in terms of the economy. but it does strike me that we are using precious time to discuss an issue where the proposers are wishing to pass on congratulations and recognise how well we've done, at the expense of maybe discussing some of the even more pressing issues that are facing us at present, such as what we're going to do in terms of economic strategy, the implications of Brexit in terms of our market access, the future of corporation tax, what we're doing in manufacturing, what we're doing in terms of the higher education funding issue. So there's a lot of very, very important issues out there on the economy that we do need to get our heads around. The second aspect is that it's simply not good enough that whenever we are looking at the very specifics around where we are in terms of sport tourism, to sit back and basically list what we've done and achieved to date and say how great this has been for our economy and how we're now on the international map, because there are some very particular issues that we do need to address on that subject itself. First of all, it has been referred to by a number of speakers, the absence of a tourism strategy. And this is not a recent development, this is now a long-running gap in terms of the suite of strategies that an executive should have in place. And clearly a tourism strategy is a fundamental cornerstone of any wider economic strategy, and it is something we do need to address as soon as possible, and indeed to also reflect the oil island dimensions and the connectivity issues in terms of the island. We should also bear in mind that tourism itself as a sector within our economy remains significantly underdeveloped relative to our comparative jurisdictions elsewhere in these islands and also internationally. So there is significant room for growth, and obviously this therefore should be a priority sector for the executive and also for the department. And indeed that demand is reflected by many across the sector itself. And indeed this is something that will have cross-cutting benefits in a whole range of different areas. It's also important whenever we look at the very specifics around sports tourism, whenever we're talking around the high profile events, to recognise that they tend to be variable. We will bid for those, and some will be successful, some less so, but they will come on a very irregular pattern to us. So if we are looking to the issues of sustainability, we can't build a strategy solely around those themselves. We need to ensure that there are proper spin-offs from the events that we do manage to attract, but also to ensure that we're investing in a balance of reasons for people to come to Northern Ireland itself. But if we are looking at the specific issue of sustainability in terms of sports and events-related tourism, one of the key issues is the level of repeat visits that will come from those who come for the initial sporting event itself, and also the recommendations that they will make to their friends and colleagues and other family members to come to Northern Ireland. In that regard, the issue of customer care is going to be very important, and I would encourage the Minister to look again at the issue of world host training to ensure that we are doing as much as we can to maximise the uptake of that across the different cities, towns and villages of Northern Ireland. And we have seen some very good examples in that regard. I think actually Derry City, during my term of office, I think was the first jurisdiction in the entire UK to achieve the status of a world host city. So that's good. In terms of also issues around training, we need to see how we can support the sector in terms of their desire to engage with work around apprenticeships and youth training. And clearly they see some very potential opportunities in that regard. Whenever Gordon Dunn was mentioning, he talked about the investment that's been made in stadia and also in terms of hotels, and we certainly note and take into account what is said in that regard. But I do need to stress that we have had a missed opportunity in Northern Ireland in relation to the development of a shared sports facility across perhaps the three leading spectator sports, and instead have gone for three separate stadia. I'm not wishing to reopen the old ground because that is now passed, but a single stadium would have brought together potential in terms of sharing, but more importantly, it would have brought us together a greater economies of scale in terms of infrastructure and the quality of infrastructure. And it is still a concern that Casement Park is an outstanding issue. That would be the largest of the three stadiums available to us.
And the member and if we bring are his to seek to attract to
a certain type of event, including the Rugby World Cup, developing Casement, albeit as a GAA statement, a stadium is absolutely of crucial importance. Thank you.
I call Tom Buchanan.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to speak on the motion today, and again of the great sporting activities that we have within Northern Ireland, and they have been mentioned by various speakers, so don't go into that. I don't intend to go into that, but to say that we are proud, or we should be proud, of the sporting professionals that we have within Northern Ireland and who represent Northern Ireland on a global basis. And I do welcome the success that the Executive have had in recent years in bringing some fine international events to the shores of Northern Ireland. And by hosting these successful events, we have seen the knock-on effects which have reverberated right across the length and breadth of Northern Ireland and the growth of our economy. Now, some people might want to turn a blind eye to that, but that is the reality of the situation, and that is what is happening through our sporting tourism. This year saw the opening of the newly refurbished and extended Waterfront Hall in Belfast, and of course this is a foretaste of the growth that is happening in Belfast as a place for business tourism. Expansion and room for growth were necessary to facilitate the boom in business tourism in our capital city. And already Belfast is tipped to be a leading destination for business tourism. And this in itself will maximise our potential for visitors to come with their families and to come back again. And of course, that's what we need to be doing, is to not only having the visitors coming in, but having that for them, that there's that interest for them to come back again to join with us here in Northern Ireland. Business tourism may prove to be one of the catalysts for boosting the wider tourism potential that Northern Ireland has to offer to the world. And by the same token, as the vision for business tourism is becoming a reality in Belfast, we need to merge government, businesses, local authorities and organisations all involved in tourism to get them to think a lot wider, on a lot wider basis, to facilitate the growth of the sporting tourism industry. When major steps have been taken to attract global sporting events to Northern Ireland, for which the Executive must be congratulated, we have to recognise the potential for the future in this rapidly growing tourism market and tap into that on a broader scale. And I know that just last week my colleague Mr Hamilton attended the draw for the Women's Rugby World Cup 2017. And this event alone, which will last for a 9-day period, will generate almost $2 million to the local economy, not to mention the priceless publicity about Northern Ireland around the world after visitors attend the event and spread the word about the attractions and the hospitality that we have here. And if we look at the Northwest 200, and look at the huge amount of people that that attracts every year from right across the world, then surely we have to say that events like this are valuable assets to the local economy and provide valuable boost to the local industry. The domino effect of bringing large-scale events to the province cannot be underestimated. The power of seeing an event broadcast around the world against the backdrop of stunning scenery is priceless. And as part of a tourism strategy, we need to move with the times. We need to set the bar higher and lead the way in establishing events. We need to be more creative. And if we look at the marathons that we have in Belfast, and I couldn't mention Belfast and mention the North West without mentioning Fermanagh, South Tyrone and West Tyrone. And you know, there's no reason why an international marathon couldn't be run in West Tyrone or in Fermanagh, South Tyrone, where you have the beauty of the Sperrins and you have the beauty of the lakes of Fermanagh. And of course that would attract them and attract them back again. And maybe that's something for the Minister to consider. As part of the tourism strategy, we need to work alongside advertising, marketing companies, tourism agencies, hoteliers, to come up with strategies to attract more people to Northern Ireland on a more regular basis. It is imperative that we are open to capitalise on trends and have the flexibility to work alongside these ever-changing trends, to implement ideas which are collated from a wide range of bodies who know the industry, having worked in it for many years. Northern Ireland is an emerald jewel and the crown of a natural rugged beauty, and when we recognise the value
of that
product,
his remarks to a close?
We have to sell to the world, then we can truly grasp what is truly unique destination that we have. 2016 has been a year of dramatic change in the political stage in this world. We should embrace the challenges, look for the opportunities that present themselves as a result, and push ahead for Northern Ireland to become legal globally.
The Member's time is up.
within
I the call Carl Nicholson.
That was a marathon speech, Tom. Fair play to you. I also support the motion, and just for clarification, when my colleague Conor Murphy was talking about his colleague in front of him as an avid racer, it isn't me, just in case. It was Philip McGuigan. But I do welcome the motion. Actually, I think it's a good debate in terms of looking at all the aspects that enhances our tourism product. I mean, someone, I think it was yourself, had said that, you know, so at times we're bringing motions forward and there's no point to them. Well, I mean, lots of people could take a view about lots of different things. And the fact that people take the time to put a motion down and there's a debate, it's always worthwhile. Even if we don't agree with it, it's still a worthwhile process. Equally, I'm heartened to hear that, certainly with Justin McAnulty's contribution, that the SDLP are now supporting the redevelopment of Casement Park, which I welcome, because I found it completely ironic that some members were complaining about a lack of investment in West Belfast, and rightly so. And yet in all, one of the members representing the SDLP, but certainly Mr Atwood was one of the two Atwoods who stood outside Casement Park against the redevelopment, and for me that was certainly would give way.
I thank the member for giving way. I'm sure that the member would recognise the right, indeed the duty, of any of us as MLAs to make representation on behalf of constituents with concerns.
Because to no me pressure, Eganbal, the member has an extra minute.
Absolutely, and to be fair to anybody, any of us could be in that situation. But my difficulty was where the line was crossed in terms of making representation, as he or anybody else is entitled to proactively arguing against such an investment, I found disturbing. I welcome the member's intervention in terms of his leadership around the whole issue, and I also now welcome his party's position. I do think in terms of the role of Casement Park in terms of the Rugby World Cup for 2023 is absolutely critical. So I look forward to this complete assembly giving support to the redevelopment of it. Will it enhance tourism? It absolutely will. Will it add to the sports activity and potential events, not just in West Belfast, but for Belfast? Yes, it will. Will that in itself, in my opinion, add towards good relations? It will. Because I grew up never putting a foot in Windsor Park, and now I do. And I do it not because I was a minister, I do it now, even though I'm not. Not to go to a soccer match, but to go to other events. But when I was growing up, there was just areas that you just didn't go to. And I think, if we're all honest, that was the case for many of us. And I think the development and the investment from our executive, and certainly big infrastructure projects, will actually help not only create awareness, but attract people to places and events that in the past they may not have considered. We have seen the rugby world, the ladies here, and the investment that's already been mentioned. We're going to see next year the UEFA Women's Under 19 Championship, and hopefully we'll get all this assembly giving those women our support because they need it. But I've witnessed fishing, world-class fishing competitions come to these shores, even to my constituency in the Waterworks, which is a small lake. But it's been brilliant. It's cross-community of people from right across the island, people from Wales and everywhere travelling for these events. But looking at things like transplant games, the recent world-class Irish dancing competitions in the Waterfront Hall as an example, and many, many other things, even in rural communities, bike trails with investment from Dard and others. And on our water and our marine activities, I think we have a lot here to enhance our tourist product. Can we all do more? Certainly. That's a given. But when we look, and when I spoke to other ministers, some of them would have given their eye teeth for the infrastructure and the investment that we've put in to some of our areas to enhance tourist product. I also welcome the fact that across the island, both institutions are working to look at events that we can host both sides of the island. And I think that that has continued, and that's a good thing. So I do believe that, particularly around tourism, NI, sport NI, the executive, local councils have a massive role to play in this. Local government has a massive role. I think when we have the joined-up approaches, and I'm seeing more of that, then you will get more world-class events. But just going back to a point that Conor Murphy raised, don't lose sight of the small events, because world-class events like Olympic and Paralympic Games inspired children and young people to get involved in sport. Some of the smaller events will do the same. What we need to do is make sure that the infrastructure is invested and maintained, and we create the opportunities not only for people to come to our shores, but for our residents, our citizens, to make sure that they too can participate in some of these events. So I too support the motion.
I call George Robinson.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. My East Londonderry constituency hosts the North West 200, the Northern Ireland Muck Cup and the Air Show, and has top quality golf courses, has been used as part of the Giro Italia route, is blessed with excellent salmon and trout fishing rivers, as well as stunning coastline which attracts sea angling. So this is why I am particularly interested in speaking on this motion. Principal Deputy Speaker, as my colleague Gordon Dunn has already alluded to, we must also remember the magnificent achievements recently of our Northern Ireland football team in reaching the last 16 of the Euro finals. To add to this, we have had some great past sporting legends such as George Best, Joey Dunlop, Alec Higgins and others, along with present sporting ambassadors, Rory McIlroy, etc., who have put Northern Ireland on the sporting map. As I have already demonstrated, much has been delivered and many events supported by the executive. I congratulate them on their successes. I also point to the future and the 2019 Open Golf Tournament that is coming to Royal Portrush. More delivery for our tourist industry. Again, congratulations to the executive. No one can say the executive is not successful in supporting our sporting events. The result is employment, economic development, and these are cornerstones for future development. With a more peaceful Northern Ireland, the potential for developing the tourist sector is immense, and as stated previously, much has already been achieved. I want to see all sectors developed, because this is one of the cornerstones to Northern Ireland's economic development. In every constituency, there are sporting events and activity-based tourism, from climbing the Mourns, surfing on our coasts, caving in Fermanagh, sea and river fishing or boating on our lakes, waterways and coasts. We have a huge sports activity, tourist product to sell to the world. This is a base for our tourist economic growth. I am confident that with this Executive Minister at the helm, Northern Ireland can be assured of the commitment to developing our tourist sector in all aspects and to utilise our sporting and activity-based tourism to the utmost. Madam Deputy Speaker, I support the motion and ask the House to follow suit. Thank you.
I call Steve Aiken.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion and the amendment and to add our support to tourism in Northern Ireland and other bodies as we seek to grow Northern Ireland as one of the key niche sporting and cultural tourism destinations in the world. Whether it is large, medium or small sporting events, cultural events or in helping to promote these events or benefiting from the wider positive image these activities have in selling Northern Ireland PLC as a great place to visit, to invest in and come and live in, our brand is something we must build up and cherish and guard from being undermined by other competitors, either here on this island or further afield. We have much to be proud of. Our strong sporting links to the golfing, motorcycle, cycling, equestrian, rugby, football, GAA, sailing, swimming, athletics, hockey. And because I am from Southampton, it would be remiss of me not to mention the great Mossley, Parkgate and Ranelstown hockey teams of my constituencies. And again, the sporting prowess exemplified by our international sports stars, Olympians and Paralympians. This does not just imply the promotion and support of sports in schools in our communities, but ensuring that we have the facilities to support our sports. Whether this is ensuring that our planners ensure that globally significant road races like the Ulster Grand Prix are not penalised by unwelcome graveyard development, or that we have the suitable venues for us to attract major sporting events. In mentioning the Ulster Grand Prix, and as a proud Ballyclarian, I would also like to put on record again my delight that Jonathan Ray on being crowned the World Superbike Champion, and I too would be delighted if here in this Assembly we would formally recognise his fantastic success. We also have to ensure that our cultural landscape is supportive of attracting major visitor numbers. I would particularly note that events such as the Belfast Tattoo, the celebration of Ulster Scots events in Glenarm, as well as arts festivals, literary events, and the great work that has gone on in Londonderry, as well as the new visitor centre celebrating Seamus Heaney in Ballachy, and that we need to effectively promote all of our sports and cultural events and tourism. So therefore, let us make sure that we appropriately invest in promotion of brand at Northern Ireland. It is noteworthy that the Irish tourism authorities are spending many multiples of Northern Ireland tourism's budget, and indeed the budget alone for the Wild Atlantic Way is much more than what we do for promotion of Northern Ireland tourism. If Northern Ireland tourism is... Yes, certainly.
I thank the member for giving way. The member brings up a very good point when he mentions the Wild Atlantic Way. That is something I would ask the minister to look at, because it's something that we need to bring up here. The Atlantic doesn't stop at the border. The Wild Atlantic Way shouldn't stop at the border either.
The member has an extra minute.
And thank you very much indeed. And as we all know, the Atlantic stretches all the way to Ballycastle and to Torhead, and that's where we should be doing, and we should be promoting the extension of the Wild Atlantic Way along that way as well. But I think, and we should commend very much Northern Ireland Tourism's desire to increase the amount of growth in the market to $1 billion per annum. If we are to do this and we are to support this growing investment, we need to help them. And as part of the strategy going forward, we need to adequately resource tourism Northern Ireland going forward. Thank you very much.
Alex Maskey. I call Alex Maskey.
I also, like my colleagues, raised to support the motion, and as I understood the last speaker, he said that the Ulster Unionist Party would also support the motion, albeit along with the amendment. And I'm not sure if that means if the amendment falls, then will the party support the motion? I'm going to hope that they would. I mean, obviously, as my colleagues have already said, particularly Conor Murphy, in our support for the motion, we will not be supporting the amendment, because it does appear to us part of the just a now standard trend from the SDLP just to be, in a way, mean-spirited in terms of just not wanting to give any recognition that the executive has done anything of any kind of substance or anything right, even though that party's had ministers in office in the last number of mandates and were quite prepared to share, and rightly so, some of the very good work that was done. Although they never take responsibility for some of the work it wasn't. But nevertheless, I do recognise that Justin McNulty in his remarks did actually acknowledge that the executive did do some good work, so to that extent I'm quite pleased to hear that, because I think that ultimately, whatever way the amendment is voted on, I don't think that any of us could really find any substantive fault with the original motion, because I do think, and I will look forward to hearing the minister, but I would expect, as Conor Murphy has already said, we would expect to hear that in any upcoming tourism strategy, and in fact right through the heart of the economic strategy eventually, that we will have substantial support and substantive support for the tourism industry, not least the sporting tourism sector as well, because quite clearly all the members have testified in the House this afternoon that this is a very important sector for quite a variety of reasons. It does certainly help a local economy, there's no question or doubt about that. It does bring more people here, it increases the spend locally within the broader community here, including the hospitality sector and so on. It also, in my opinion, Shirley.
Member for giving way, he mentions the hospitality sector, and obviously one of the big issues around hospitality is the review of licensing laws, which the committee and the minister are looking at the moment. Would he not agree with me that a more radical approach to that particular issue would be very helpful in terms of supporting our economy and supporting economic growth?
And the member has an extra minute. No mate, breath shaking back.
Well, I thank the member for that intervention, and there's no doubt that Well, even from my own experience in the last mandate, I would have been very clearly on the record of saying we need an overhaul of the licensing legislation, and I would look forward to that in the time ahead, because no doubt that that would also be a benefit if it's improved in the right and appropriate manners. As I've said, I think for me, very importantly, economic benefits accruing to our community here through sporting and tourism events is very, very important. But even beyond that, it actually does continue then to increase the people here's involvement in sports, because there's no doubt that whilst the motion refers to the executive achieving good things in the past, there's no doubt then that all of those other organisations, be it the tourism bodies and the sporting bodies, and all of those participants and activists and sportsmen and women who have inspired many of us here, inspired people around the world, I think that the continued success of the sports tourism industry in the sector will add to the number of people who will be involved in sport. That has an overall beneficial, certainly a benefit to our society here, because it increases people's participation, addresses social exclusion. It's far better for people's health and well-being and all the rest of that. So it's a no-brainer, really, if we can increase the support of that sector. One of the things that has came through in this particular debate is everybody, whilst acknowledging all of the very important major sporting events, and there are very, very many of them to be acknowledged, and rightly so, and we're very thankful for that, the prowess of our sports people, and all of the people who support them, their coaches and their trainers, their families and so on. But certainly the smaller events, I think all the members have testified to the fact that there are many much smaller sporting events which really go unsung. And I would just mention one which I had the benefit of meeting with on Friday past, and that's just a small event which involves two amateur boxing clubs, St Paul's in West Belfast and Scorpion in Ballymoney. Those two clubs have came together. They have developed a partnership with Detroit. They're hoping to bring over a party of people here from Detroit, which hopefully will include Thomas Hearns, another world-class world champion, very, very famous in our generation. And there's no doubt there that the relatively small party they will bring over here will increase the tourism spend in this, not only in Belfast, but obviously there's a very good programme of events already arranged around that particular one small programme. It is only one. There's a previous and similar initiative called Beltway, which marries up people from Washington, and they originally was an Ardoyne club, certainly mainly Belfast, but not exclusively so. So these smaller sporting events are very, very important, not only for the local economy, but also, as I said, for the well-being of people here, because there are more and more people being involved in sports. And of course, when people are coming here to take part in those sporting events, they're then taking part in other parts of the, and they're availing themselves of other parts of our tourism industry. That's just all for the good and all for the better for everybody concerned. So I would like to commend the executive for all the work that has been done over the last number of years, and in particular, of course, commend all of those people who have been involved in the sporting achievements and the tourism and other sporting bodies which have helped. As I say, so I look forward to hearing from the Minister other substantive support that will be given to these events in the future.
I call Paul Frew.
Much, and I rise, of course, to support the motion and the acknowledge the work that has been done to date. And I will, I suppose, at the outset, I will give an invitation out to Mr Chambers to come up and to visit North Antrim, where he can attend the Ballymoney Town Hall and learn all about the road racing history in Northern Ireland, and also to, on his way back home, call in at the Ballymoney Showgrounds, where he'll see our Hall of Fame that has represented within its hall Willie John McBride, none other, Eamon Loughran, Michael O'Neill, Maeve and Sean Kyle and Nigel Worthington. So there are a lot of examples where there are museums about acknowledging and supporting the work in all sports, in all guises and all individuals. And I would disagree with them. If we focus on a museum, we could sometimes lose sight of the future and the future potential and the growth that we need to inject funding into and support into to make sure that we achieve and we help and assist the athletes of the future, not spend money on a museum that shows us what happened in the past. But I would like to, I rise to acknowledge the work that the organisers do, say, of the Northwest 200, very close to my constituency, who, where my constituency benefits greatly from that event. Northwest 200, what a massive event, free at the point of view. Where else would you get that in the world? We have the Milk Cup, the Super Cup now as it's called, and the tremendous work that does with young people and people around the world. We also have our golfing, and look at what has been achieved at the very highest levels, Rory McIlroy, Graham McDowell and Darren Clark, and of course Michael Hoy, who I think at this time he's 5 times winner on the European Tour. That's maybe 6 maybe now this year. And Michael Hoy has done a lot of work with the Gogorham Castle Golf Club in representing and being an ambassador for Northern Ireland Open, Northern Ireland's annual professional golf tournament. And whilst it's good that Northern Ireland can attract the Irish Open, and of course now the Open in 2019, we also should look at the potential of the Northern Ireland Open. At the minute, that is a Challenge Tour tournament. It's second division, if you like, in the European golf terms. But it has already, and it's only been going since 2013, where it had over 22,000 spectators. In 2014, 34,000 spectators, and now in 2015 and 16, 39,000 spectators. And in fact, the grand total for 2016 was 39,721 spectators. It was won by a man, Ryan Fox, from New Zealand. And that's the potential that Northern Ireland Open has. But not only to stay, and by the way, that actually broke, they've broken the Challenge Tour attendance records in the last 2 years. So that is telling me that, if, in effect, Northern Ireland Open has outgrown that division of European golf. And to go up higher, you're talking about the same tour, the same professional tour, as the Irish Open, the Scottish Open, the French Open, the Spanish Open and all the rest. How good would it be if Northern Ireland gets a slot in that diary? To be at the very peak of European golf, and we can do it. Gogorham Castle, and I pay tribute to the owner, Christopher Brooke, and the work that he has done on that ground, the investment that he has made, and also to his managing director, Gary Henry, who's also the main organiser of the Northern Ireland Open. These people can put Northern Ireland on the map. We can compete right up there with the Irish Open. It's good to have the Irish Open in Portrush, Newcastle, Royal County Down, and now in Port Stewart. But we can do this every year. We can have a tournament of that calibre every year through the Northern Ireland Open. And why should we not? Why should we not strive to get there and to have this as an annual event? We have the infrastructure around Ballymena. We have the golf course. I know the Minister has played it. I've seen him in action this year.
Is he any good?
Well, I think he should get a tour invitation. You never know. I'll take half of his prize money. But this is a tremendous opportunity.
Can I
for
ask
Northern
the
Ireland
member to bring his comments to a
and
close?
For the Northern Ireland Open. And I hope the Minister will look at that and see what way we can grow the Northern Ireland Open. Thank you.
Thank you. I call the Minister for the Economy, Simon Hamilton.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. A little bit thrown there by Mr. Freeze's final comments. A very kind invitation for him to join me on the tour. I think he was offering him his services as an agent or something,
a caddy
perhaps, an agent looking to take half of my winnings, but half of zero, of course, is still zero. But I'd like to thank all of the members who have contributed to the debate, and I'll particularly thank Mr. Storey, Mr. Buchanan, Mr. Dunn and Mr. Lyons for tabling the motion that is before us. At times during the course of the debate, as debates of this nature can tend to do, it did sound like a bit of a sort of a tourism NI brochure for each individual constituency in Northern Ireland, but well done to those members who availed of the opportunity to promote the various attractions of their own particular areas. The motion states, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, that Northern Ireland has been very successful in bidding for and hosting a range of high-profile sporting events in the last few years, and that is undoubtedly the case, and I don't think anybody denied that in any of their contributions. From the Titanic centenary in 2012, when the world spotlight shone on Belfast for all of the right reasons, to the hosting of events such as the MTV European Music Awards, the Irish Open in Portrush, and the range of other high-profile NI 2012 celebrations, major public events have become extremely important to the Northern Ireland tourism industry, to the further promotion of our tourism product, and of course to the wider economy. The follow-up from that tipping point, as it were, in 2012 has been extremely good. Londonderry's year as the first ever UK city of culture in 2013 was a resounding success. We then had a series of further major events such as the World Police and Fire Games, the Giro d'Italia Big Start and the 2015 Tall Ships Festival. Aside from their individual and economic successes, collectively all of these events have not just served to greatly improve Northern Ireland's profile as a place where major events can take place, but they have also increased the likelihood and potential for Northern Ireland to host bigger events, sporting and otherwise, in the future. I'm delighted, for instance, that World Rugby has chosen to award the hosting rights for the Women's Rugby World Cup 2017 to the Irish Rugby Football Union. This prestigious tournament will be held in Belfast and in Dublin in August of next year, and Northern Ireland will undoubtedly benefit from the global coverage which goes with such an important event. Northern Ireland Executive is also very supportive of the bid to host the Rugby World Cup in 2023, and I'm delighted that Ireland is through to the second phase of the bid process, and I know that a lot of work will go into this next phase to secure a winning bid. Northern Ireland will also host the 2017 UEFA European Women's Under-19 Championship. Securing this football tournament is particularly exciting considering the recent success of our men's senior team, who did so well in the summer's European Championships in France. The Grand Fondo of the Giro d'Italia will return next year as part of the successful legacy event, and some members in their contributions talked about the legacy of big events that we attract in Northern Ireland. In 2015-16, the event attracted 3,066 participants, it was 21% of which were from outside of Northern Ireland, with the 2016-17 event attracting 4,399 participants, 14% of which came from outside of the province. The impact of events of this type is instant, with riders and their friends and families filling up hotels, enjoying our local food and drink and attractions, and experiencing our unique cycling trails, increasing international visitors and generating revenue for local businesses. Yes.
I thank the Minister for giving way, and he makes a very compelling case in terms of the assessment he does of the economic outturn of those issues which are supported by the Executive. However, there are day and daily sporting events which take place. I mean, there are 10 world champions, for example, in kickboxing in my own constituency. They bring people from Japan, the US and right across Europe here, and they have a multiplicity of championships there. That's not work supported by the Executive. Do you do any assessment? Does the Minister do any assessment of the value of that to the economy, as well as to participation in sport?
The member will know. Yeah, I think that, I mean, it was a topic that was raised by many principal deputy speaker in their contributions about, while celebrating, and I'm sure the member does agree in celebrating the large events, both homegrown and international, that we have established or attracted over the years, that there is an importance for local events, and I've heard that loud and clearly. And obviously there are a range of events at local level that have been supported, not always through the Executive, admittedly, but mostly through local government, and I think that is the principal way in which that should be done, to reflect the needs of a local community. But hold on a second, I know the member likes to talk, but look, just let me finish my point. Look, I'm happy if the member has any particular cases that she wants to raise with me. I'm very happy to take a look at them. In terms
Can I
of the
ask
economic,
that all members make comments through the chair?
Principal Deputy Speaker, in terms of assessing the need of those, the impact of those, I'll take a reflect on any particular events that the member raises. I know that councils, as I mentioned, who principally fund those events at a very, very local level, will do their impact assessments in terms of what the impact has been on the local economy so that they can justify the expenditure that's placed on them. But I do think it's a very, very important, whether it is very, very localised events or events that attract people in from elsewhere in the British Isles or indeed further beyond, it is important that as we focus at an executive level perhaps on some of those bigger events, that there are those smaller events at a local level which will allow people to participate, and they can be inspired perhaps by some of the bigger events. But certainly they can be encouraged to participate at local level and local events. Happy to give way to the member if she has another point to make.
Thank you. The point that I'm making to the Minister is not that these are local events, but that these are international, these are world championships. They're not supported by any government funding, but they do take place in Northern Ireland on a regular basis. It's not just a local event.
Except, and the member will appreciate that as successful as we have been over the last number of years in attracting some major sporting events, some of which I've mentioned already, some of which I'm sure I'll mention throughout the remainder of my contribution, we do so on a on a basis of what will bring in a return for the wider economy, what will bring in a return from terms of improving our tourism product. That isn't to say that other events that are held at a local level, which are international in nature, are seen as in any way inferior, but the member will appreciate that there is a limited budget available to me and my department through its agencies to support a range of events. So we can't support every single event that is out there. To do so would dilute the pot and therefore get a far less good return for our investment than supporting those bigger events that we have mentioned already. I'm also delighted that the Dubai duty-free Irish Open will return to Northern Ireland next July, with Port Stewart Golf Club being the host venue. Tourism NI and my department are working with partners in the European Tour, Causeway Coast and Glens Council, Tourism Ireland and wider tourism industry to deliver another great Irish Open, the third to be held in Northern Ireland in the last 5 years. The Irish Open has, of course, been one of the key factors in attracting the Open Championship to Royal Portrush, and next year's Irish Open will provide the perfect stepping stone to the excitement and drama which I'm sure will happen at the biggest tournament in world golf, which will take place here in 2019. The Open's return to Northern Ireland is a hugely significant step forward. Securing this tournament was a key part of Tourism NI's event strategy, and unquestionably it will further consolidate Northern Ireland's reputation as the home of outstanding events and boost efforts to grow domestic and overnight visitor numbers and spend. The Royal and Ancient retains global research company Repucom to conduct an annual branded content analysis of the Open Championship. They estimate that the combined tourism promotion and economic development will be up to £70 million, with 200,000 spectators expected at Royal Portrush over the competition days. The hosting of major golf events, including our own, as mentioned by Mr. Frew, Northern Ireland Open, and as with all major sporting events we manage to attract, continues to play a key role in realising our ambitious plans to grow tourism here to a £1 billion industry by 2020. Whether it is world-class homegrown motor sports events like the Northwest 200, the Circuit of Ireland and the Ulster Grand Prix, or major one-off internationals, they all have the capacity to showcase our people and places on a global stage. Events drive visitor numbers, generate increased spend, and also provide platforms for the visitor to interact with the local culture, local people, and explore our scenic landscapes and cities. In terms of activity tourism, and I have to say, when I'm on holiday, I'm anything other than I will. Yes, I will. Yes, I am.
I thank the Minister for giving way and noting what the Leader of the Alliance Party said. Could I ask you this question? The British Open is going to be a game changer of all game changers for tourism and for sports tourism in Northern Ireland. Can I ask the Minister, given that we are within touching distance of 2019, in terms of marketing and promotion, will you have a bespoke budget line in and around the British Open 2019 to deal with issues of infrastructure, marketing, promotion, training, skills, and anything else that will make that event as big as possible, given the scale of it already? Is there going to be a bespoke strategy, bespoke money, bespoke efforts, bespoke ambitions? Because that's the measure of whether or not you're putting meat on the bones of a tourism strategy.
Thank you, Member, for his contribution, and not unexpected around golf. And the Member is a far better golfer than I am. And I know he was a great supporter of golf, and particularly back at the Irish Open when it first came to Royal Portrush in terms of regeneration of that area. And I know that's something that my ministerial colleague, Paul Given, will want to ensure. And I know that he's actively working on that front to ensure that the benefits of the Irish Open, or sorry, the Open Championship, which the member is right. I mean, this is at an entirely different level. And I know that members will want to promote events in their particular areas, but this is a truly, truly international global event, the like of which we haven't seen in Northern Ireland perhaps ever. Even when it was hosted here in the 50s, it wasn't at the level, anywhere near the level that it is now. And the member's right that we need to absolutely capitalise on that, and I'd be absolutely adamant that this is an opportunity that we will not be missing. Yes, the Open Championship, and the intention is that it comes back on a regular basis, but we won't miss this opportunity in 2019 to make sure that there are other benefits in terms of regeneration, other benefits in terms of improving the skills and infrastructure in the surrounding area and right across Northern Ireland. In terms of activity tourism, which the motion mentions as well, this area is one of the key themes, I think, for unlocking the potential of Northern Ireland as a tourist destination. The beauty and variety of our landscapes, the compact distances that we have in our ever-changing landscape may make Northern Ireland a wonderful place to undertake all types of outdoor activity. Activity tourism is estimated to be worth about £100 million to the Northern Ireland economy annually, and due to the diversity and the range of activities available is well placed to grow further. Activity tourism marketing is delivered through a service level agreement with Outdoor Recreation Northern Ireland, who are responsible for industry engagement and the development of activity-specific websites. The activity tourism sector here is a young and vibrant one, representing a confident Northern Ireland, and in that context, Tourism and I's activity product priorities are currently focused on five areas: adventure, walking, mountain biking, cycling and canoeing. The Tourism and I in terms of local events, many members talked about local events and particularly in their own areas, in their own constituencies. Tourism and I introduced in 2014 a three-year letter of offer fund for international events and administration of the National Fund as a sponsorship scheme. However, that events programme is currently the subject of a review being conducted by my department, which is likely to take a number of months to conclude. In the interim, however, Tourism and I has put in place a one-year programme to support events whilst the review and strategy are completed. A new tourism strategy for Northern Ireland to 2025 is also currently being developed by my department, and as part of that new tourism event strategy to 2025 will emerge to support the delivery of the overarching tourism strategy targets. There's a new appreciation of the potential for tourism to contribute to the growth of the Northern Ireland economy and to deliver on jobs and investment. We've worked very hard in Northern Ireland to improve visitor perception and to build on our reputation as the home of great events. We must continue this hard work with a focus on improving further our reputation internationally and our attractiveness as a destination. When we play host, we all join in and we go the extra mile. Our new tourism strategy will have a global focus, one which will set Northern Ireland as a internationally competitive and inspiring destination. That new tourism strategy will have the sole aim of transforming Northern Ireland into the world-class tourism destination we know that it can be. And we are pursuing that aim on strong foundations. The annual tourism statistics show that in 2015, we had 4.5 million overnight trips with associated expenditure of £764 million, a 3% increase. We had 2.3 million external visitors, the highest number on record, and a 6% year-on-year increase. Hotel room occupancy was 67%, up 2%. Northern Ireland also welcomed nearly 70 cruise ships with 123,000 passengers. More recently, NISR occupancy statistics for January to September this year revealed record room occupancy levels over the summer period, with August hotel occupancy reaching 88%, the highest on record for any month. Factors that may bode well over the rest of the year include recent favourable currency movements, and this will potentially be supported by improvements in air connectivity over the winter, with 10 new routes from Spain, Poland, Germany and Italy, and also a new route to Brussels. World-renowned events such as those that we have been speaking of today, Principal Deputy Speaker, will continue to play a vital role in attracting external visitors, helping to enhance our international reputation as a destination of choice and to provide world-class experiences for all. Northern Ireland has already had significant success in bidding for and hosting a range of major global events. We're in a strong position to continue this success and to attract sporting events and tourists who wish to engage in a range of outdoor activities.
I call Sinead Bradley to wind on the amendment. Éireann Sir, Sinead Bradley.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to wind on the amendment, and I start with comments made with my party colleague Justin McNulty, who rightly referred to events such as the Irish Open and could barely contain himself, being the sporting man he is, when he referred to the bid for the Rugby World Cup and something about a haka on the mall in Armagh. There was also reference made, and rightly so, about embracing the GAA, and the scale and support across the world that exists for the GAA is largely unmeasured, but it is something this executive must embrace, and considering the fact that we are the homeland of those Gaelic Games. And Justin McNulty also rightly raised the fact that there is this one event thinking that is going on at the moment, successfully at times, where events are captured and brought here, but we must extend beyond that way of thinking. Alan Chambers also made a contribution expressing his concern that the Minister's party once again have brought forward a motion for debate, which really calls for nothing more than what we should already consider to be agreed. And he also made calls about a sporting museum, which he thought to be a precious addition to any strategy. Stephen Farrey, in his contribution, rightly, I suppose, highlighted what we will discuss further, the self-congratulatory tone of the motion. But he also went on to mention and bring in discussion around all-island connectivity and the methods of repeat visits, customer care and, rightly, the training that would be required to make a visitor's experience one that they would wish to return to and share again. We then also had a contribution from Steve Aiken, who referred to the Wild Atlantic Way, which I think is something we look on in envy, and there are things and lessons to be learned there. But he acknowledged the good work of many organisations and individuals who have contributed to the sector and the success of sporting tourism to date. What we must ask ourselves, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, is why would tourists come here? What are the events that would attract them? How do they get here? And there is the uncomfortable truth of the United Airlines story, which should not be repeated in this House. There's also issues around the Enterprise service, which is all but barely functioning right now. And some tourists might even like to approach my own constituency of South Down via a bridge at Narrowwater. So the infrastructure should be there and the means of getting here. How do they get here? Where do they stay? I'm very conscious that there are hotel plans that are sitting with planning service not getting through the system. There must be this out of silo thinking and a joined up approach to where people are going to stay and what their experience will be. What activities and pursuits will they engage in while here? At the same time, we're talking about the possible threat of closure to outdoor educational centres. Opportunities that don't exist in other constituencies, opportunities to go and partake in sports that otherwise people would not have an opportunity to engage in. And what opinion will those tourists leave with when they have had the Northern Ireland hospitality experience? Again, that goes back to Stephen Farrey's comments about training, about us really being not just open for business, but successfully open for good business and giving our tourists an experience to remember. Yes, I will give way.
Can I thank the member for giving way? Could I just ask the member that, while she's lamenting the fact that, for example, the Narrowwater Bridge hasn't yet been developed, but she would not accept the fact that her party colleagues, many of them, were supporting all of those parties in the last Southern mandate, which actually withdrew the money that the Irish government had committed to the Narrowwater Bridge project.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you. No, I don't accept that. In fact, if I remember correctly, it was your own party colleague who was in office when the money was not brought forward for the bridge. So, speaking then directly to the amendment, Conor Murphy, on behalf of Sinn Féin, gave first light as to why his party did not believe that they could support the amendment as tabled. And he gave... added to the fact that he believes that SDLP at any cost will come in here and take merit from the executive, which I can assure you is not the case. And if the member perhaps took time, if he doesn't want to listen to me, perhaps take time to actually read the amendment, he will see that the amendment does go further than the original motion. The amendment adds a sense of urgency. It asks to address the need for capital, resourcing, marketing, skills and training. Now, if the member is serious in that they do not accept that as being additional factors to be considered in this amendment, I find that statement quite disingenuous. And in fact, I would go further. I would say that when I listen to the debate, and this is going to be perhaps the routine, that despite what amendment is tabled, that parties will simply look through that amendment with a get-out, to find a get-out. I don't see the get-out here, and I think Sinn Féin should really reflect before they decide on how they vote on this. And I would ask them, while they're comfortable going for the softer language, is there a fear of accountability? Rather than vote for the promotion and encouragement of economic growth, why not call for the real and substantial growth? And I would put it to this House today, increasingly, I suspect this executive will become known as the executive that likes to share the blame but never the credit.
I call Gordon Lyons to wind on the proposal.
Thank you very much, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'm very pleased to be able to wind on this debate, and I thank members for their contributions. There is a reason why we have brought this motion before the House today. It's the same as the other motions that we have brought as members of the Economy Committee on the Economic Strategy, on exports, on SMEs, and now on activity and sports-based tourism. It's because we want to set out our stall. It's because we want to show the priorities that we have and what we would like to see included in the various strategies that the Minister is going to be bringing forward. And I know it's hard for some members of the opposition to take in, but the Executive has had some success on these issues. And I know you would prefer it if we didn't, but we are going to talk about the successes that we have. I know you're trying to get a narrative together that everything's bad, that everything's terrible, and that we're awful, awful people. But we've had successes, and I'm afraid you're going to have to listen to some of those successes as well. If the member has something useful to say, I'll give way.
Yes. Thank the member for giving way. I'd just like the member to answer if all these successes have taken place in the past 5 months.
No, they have happened before then. As well, but we certainly have successes, and I'm sure by the end of this Assembly term we will have even more that we will be able to speak about. So we want to talk about these successes, we will continue to have these successes, and we hope that through the new tourism strategy we will be able to address some of these issues, because we have had successes in relation to tourism as well. You only have to look at some of the figures. Highest number of external visitors, hotel occupancy up, the highest number of overnight stays, huge progress in developing our tourism potential as well, and our tourism product here in Northern Ireland. Be it just over the last number of years, the Titanic Centre, the visitor centre at the Giant's Causeway, and opening next year for good will be the Goblin's Path in East Antrim. But in the meantime, don't worry, if you want to visit East Antrim, there are many other attractions that you can come and see, and we look forward to that happening as soon as possible. So it is right that we look at areas in which we can see room for improvement as well. And one of the reasons why we brought this motion to the House was that we have a significant portion of a tourist offering in terms of these larger sports events or activity-based tourism. And what we're saying to the Minister today is, when that tourism strategy is being put together, let's not forget about that and about how important that they can be. And that is the basis of our motion today. I want to just address briefly some of the criticisms that have been made of the motion. This was not meant to be a motion that was going to divide the House or cause any problems within the House. We think it's fairly straightforward, fairly simple, and something that everyone can buy into. That was the way in which the motion was drafted. But we have complaints that, it doesn't include all of the sporting organisations that have been involved in the success. And absolutely, we need to acknowledge the work that sporting and other organisations have had, which have led to the success. But as an Assembly, we're here to call on the Executive to do things and for the Executive to take action, and that's why we're pointing out some of the steps that could be taken. To move on to what other members have said briefly, first of all, I thank Gordon Dunn for opening the debate and highlighting the importance of activity and sports events for our tourism sector and all of the benefits that can come from that. He only mentioned North Down twice, which I suppose is some kind of a record for him, but no doubt he will continue to mention it in the future. And of course, he had to mention motorsport as well, and the opportunity that can come from that. In terms of Justin McNulty's contribution, he's no longer here, but he mentioned the reason for the amendment. And I have to say, I think it was just for no other reason than to have a pop at the Executive, and I don't see any real reason for putting that amendment in. Of course, it took him almost 6 minutes, but he was able to mention Brexit and said about the uncertainty that is causing for the tourism sector. Well, I don't know what figures he's been looking at, because regardless of your view on Brexit, surely people can see the benefits that are coming from the changes that have occurred in the pound and how beneficial that has been. Conor Murphy had mentioned some constituency issues and mentioned the keen cycler who was in front of him, which has Carolyn Cullen has pointed out, was not her. Maybe Sammy Douglas can encourage her to take that up. But he was absolutely right in what he said, that any tourism strategy must be well done, not half-baked. And timely, and we look forward to the publication of that. Alan Chambers talked about the sports museum that he wants to see. He didn't give away where he wanted that to be, probably in North Down. If he does want it in North Down, he will of course have the support anyway of Gordon Dunn, so he's got two votes in favour of that already. It's a shame he didn't give way, because I would have liked to have heard a little bit of the debate between himself and Paul Frew on that. Now, in regards to Stephen Farry, he mentioned the importance of not just having high-profile events. That's not what this motion is calling for. We want to see those high-profile, major international events, and not just one-offs, but it's entirety about activity-based and sports events and the tourism that come from that. I will give way very briefly.
Thank you very much for giving way. Would the member agree with me then that a lot has been talked today in this debate around massive sporting events? Would you agree with me that more needs to be given towards the Women's World Cup, Rugby World Cup next year, and also the Under-19 European Women's Football Championships next year, that women are certainly at...
I think the point, first of all, is that both are being supported, of course. They are getting funded. But also, that's exactly the point of the motion. It's about making sure that we are getting the support for these. So, I would just challenge Stephen Farry on that. Now, Stephen Farry also was very interesting, because he complained about how the motion was all about self-congratulations. Well, the Alliance would know all about self-congratulations. They do it often and often enough themselves. So maybe I will take a lecture from him on that. But as I've said, look, we're not going to shy away from our accomplishments as much as he would prefer it. If we did not. Tom Buchanan rightly talked about the pride that we should have in our sporting heroes in Northern Ireland, and certainly other members mentioned that during the course of the debate, and it is important that we do that, because that has been the catalyst for so much of the success that we have had. And he also made a very important point about ensuring that we have the infrastructure necessary in Northern Ireland. He also floated a novel idea of a marathon through West Tyrone and Fermanagh, South Tyrone, and maybe he can continue to be a cheerleader for that. I've mentioned already, Carolyn Cullen had made very clear that she was not the cyclist that Conor Murphy was referring to, but she did mention the role of local government, and that is important, that we ensure that all levels of government are involved in this where possible. George Robinson, of course, extolled the virtues of his own constituency and the fantastic tourist product that we have on the North Coast. And I also welcome the fact that he did elaborate somewhat on the activity-based aspect of it, because it's not just about the big sporting international events, it's the other things that we have here in terms of the activity side of things, which we should be proud of, and which there is room for growth and investment. Steve Aiken mentioned Jonathan Ray, and absolutely, I'm sure the whole House will want to congratulate him. He went off topic slightly, not that that stopped him in the past, and talked about the cultural and literary and Ulster Scots side of things. Not what the motion is addressing, but absolutely right, because we have a product there that is worth selling, and we want to make sure that that is realised. Alex Maskey nailed it, in my opinion, when he referred to the SDLP reasons for putting forward this amendment. Also made a very important point on health and wellbeing and the importance that can have for our people. Paul Frew, again, highlighted our sporting heroes, and in particular those from North Antrim, and told us something of his golf knowledge and perhaps some of his ambitions for the future as well. Can I just mention then finally the Minister, and to thank him for the comments that he has made. It is good to hear that the tourism strategy is being developed, that it will include the issues that we have been discussing here now as well. And again, he mentioned the activity-based side of tourism, which I think we maybe could have mentioned a little bit more during the debate. And the targets that he has set
set out as well.
Can the member bring his comments to a close?
I thank the members who have taken part in this debate. I think we've put forward our position and I'd ask members to support it. We commend the motion to the House.
And I have to say I'm very disappointed that tennis didn't get mentioned in the entire debate. But anyway, that'll happen in the next one. The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
Aye.
I think.
Aye.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Can members resume their seats? Can members resume their seats? The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Clear the lobbies. Can we have tellers?
Thank you.
Order. Order. Can members resume their seats? Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Gerry Mullen and Justin McNulty. Tellers for the noes are Adrian McQuillan and George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Thank you. Can members please resume their seats? Can members please resume their seats? Order. Can members please resume their seats? Clerk, can you please read the result?
94 members voted, 38 members voted aye, 56 members voted no. The amendment therefore falls.
The amendment falls. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The Assembly is now adjourned. Yeah.